Let's stand and worship.
We praise you, O God, for the Son of your love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. All glory and praise to the God of all grace, who has bought us and sought us and guided our ways. Hallelujah, yours is the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, yours is the glory. Revive us again. You, O God, for your spirit of light, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Revive us again. We sing hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Revive us again. And we sing our praise to the Lamb that was slain. And we sing our praise to the Lamb that was slain. Oh, we sing our praise to the Lamb that was slain. Yeah, we sing our praise to the Lamb, to the Lamb, to the Lamb. Hallelujah, yours is the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Sing hallelujah, yours is the glory. Revive us again. Sing hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Revive us again. Revive us again. Revive us again. Revive us again.
Amen, church. Have a seat.
Good morning. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the Springs this morning. And we're so grateful for the presence of each of you. My name is Leah Redling, and I direct the youth ministry here. And a group of us just returned on Wednesday evening from a two-week mission trip in Belgium. We would like to say thank you very much for sending us. And we wanted to take just a moment to share a couple of stories with you. So if Matt and Aaron and Logan and Avery would please join me on the stage. I wish that every one of us could share a story this morning because we all have them. But these four volunteered, or I picked on them. And so I wanted you to hear from them. So Matt, I want you to go first. We did lots of prep for this work, and the kids were looking for some specific things while we were in Belgium. And Matt, I would like for you to share with our friends and family here where you saw God working in Belgium, because I know that that's what you were looking for.
I saw God work through the kids, all the kids you've met, whether it was in the neighborhood in Antwerp or if it was at the camp in Spa, because, you know, we never actually, like, knew or were sure of if we were able to connect with them properly, you know, being in another country, speaking a different language than us. And it was just truly amazing seeing how God works, you know, through all places in the world, you know, whether, you know, don't matter the culture or language or, you know, nothing, you know, if you love God, then, you know, you have a proper connection with them. And it went really good, you know, with camp and neighborhood kids playing sports, you know, whether it was just talking with them or playing around or singing or whatever. It was great.
Thank you. Same question for Aaron Giddens.
I saw God mostly, well, I saw God really everywhere, but I really saw God in our youth group that went, because we all got out of our comfort zone. We went to a place that none of us really knew what was going to happen. And we did have our ups and downs. We had sicknesses, stressness, or that's even a word. Breakdowns. I can't talk today. And homesickness, just everything like went well, but there was also some things that went bad. But I don't know what I'm saying. Okay. I had this written down, but okay, yeah. But even though we had all those hardships and stuff, once we got to see the kids from the neighborhood and the camp and everything, we put those troubles behind us when we put God first. So I really am thankful that that happened. So, yeah.
Thank you. Logan, my question for you was, what was your favorite mission moment while we were in Belgium?
My favorite missions moment was while we were in the church in Antwerp in the neighborhood. One of my favorite thing was just talking and with a few of the boys. They were around like 14, and there were three of them that were not a part of the church that we just met in the park. And I really, really enjoyed. Just talking with them, because they knew a lot of English, and they don't even take it in school until next year, like as a class. And so, but for me, like, just that small disconnect, because he would pull out his phone for Google Translate every once in a while, like, and it helped me relate a little bit. Just like that little bit of disconnect made it so much more fun and so much more like accomplishment. Like, I felt like we're communicating, and it's not like it is like this. It's a little bit more difficult, but it makes it that much more rewarding. So yeah, just, you know, being able to communicate and make friends with someone who has that little bit of disconnect.
Thank you, Logan. One of the things we asked the kids to do was set goals before we went, and I've asked Avery to share what her goal was and how it was met and how she plans to move forward after this.
Okay, so my goal was to see if I have a heart for mission work and if that's something that I want to do further on in life. And my goal was met by, I just fell in love with Belgium and I loved everything about it. So I'm starting to think about doing a 6-week Let's Start Talking program sometime in the future.
Thank you, guys. You can sit. You all have every reason to be so proud of these kids. And we thank you from the bottom of our hearts for letting us go. And know that you're loved.
We have got fantastic kids, do we not, at this church? I mean, fantastic kids. And we missed you. This little section right here, it just so vacated, and it just, we were sad in one way, but we were so happy for you in Belgium. I know you were such a blessing to Carol and Paul and the church in Antwerp, and we're just so proud of all of you. And if you ever wonder why we send kids and adults to the mission field, it's because of like an Avery who wants to dedicate some of her life in the mission field. And I will guarantee you others there will be wonderful contributors to mission work because of their experience of being over with our missionaries. So glad to have you back. See some visitors. Glad you're with us. Want to ask that you hang around. We would love to meet you. So if you'll just kind of hang around, if you'll look real pitiful, there may be somebody that might take you out to lunch. So do that. It's good to see some of our vacationers back. I see several families. It's been going 2 or 3 weeks, and you look rested and ready to go, and glad to have you back in our fellowship. David Ross, the last couple of weeks, has been talking about the beginning process of selecting some new shepherds here at the Springs. And so we're going to begin that in earnest here in the next couple of weeks. We're going to, in our Bible class for a couple of weeks in August, we're going to share some things of a shepherd that you need to be aware of and to look for some of these characteristics. We'll also be going around to our small groups, the elders will be, and in more of a non-formal setting, allow you to ask questions about the Springs and about the selection process. And then this morning, I'll kind of kick it off in our elder moments in the next 10 weeks in sharing a characteristic you should look for in, as we look at new leaders. John Osborne is going to be helping us in that process of selecting. And he said something the other day that I really, really liked. And so I'll kick it off with this one. He said, we need to find candidates who really love the Springs. We need to find candidates who really love the Springs. And it's kind of interesting. I watched the other day the old movie with James Stewart. 1965 acclaimed movie called Shenandoah, where Doug McClure asked for his daughter's hand in marriage. And he said, why do you want to marry her? And he said, because I love her. And he said, that's not good enough. Do you really like her? And so look for candidates who really like this family. And I also want to encourage you to pray. Pray every week as we kind of lead toward the 1st of October, when we're going to ask you to give us names of candidates to fill the role as leaders here with this church family, okay? All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We appreciate your goodness. We appreciate your kindness expressed in so many ways every day. Father, we just give you honor and glory, and where you've led this church to this point. We're so excited as we look to our future and what's in store for us and what's ahead. Help us to be pliable. Help us to be flexible to your will, whatever that is. And Father, help us in our look to the future in selecting those who would lead us. And we're looking for strong leadership, and we're looking for those who love this church, who model after the good shepherd Jesus Christ, who would lay down his life for the sheep, and anyone who would lay their life down obviously loves them and really likes them. Father, we love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and worship together. incomparable beauty of God draw you in.
Wonderful, so wonderful is your unfailing love. Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart could fully know how glorious, how beautiful you are. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must see. Oh, powerful, so powerful, your glory fills the skies. Your mighty works displayed for all to see. The beauty of your majesty awaits my heart to sing. How marvelous, how wonderful you are. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must see. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must see. You've opened my eyes to your wonders anew. You've captured my heart with this love, 'cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. You've opened my eyes to your wonders anew. You've captured my heart with this love, 'cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you.
Declare it one more time.
You've opened my eyes to your wonders anew. You've captured my heart with this love, 'cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must see.
Wholeheartedly committed to you. O Lord, my God, I will give you thanks with my whole heart. I will honor your name continually, for you will extend your great loyal love to me and will deliver my life from the depths of Sheol. O God, arrogant men attack me. A gang of ruthless men who do not respect you seek my life. But you, O Lord, are a compassionate and merciful God. You are patient and demonstrate great loyal love and faithfulness. Turn toward me and have mercy on me. Give your servant your strength. Deliver your slave. Show me evidence of your favor. Then those who hate me will see it and be ashamed. For you, O Lord, will help me and comfort me. Exalted far above all gods.
exalt thee, oh Lord, we exalt thee, we exalt thee, we exalt thee, oh. Be seated.
One of the other lectionary readings for this week is the story from Genesis of Jacob and his dream, and that's what I'll be reading from Genesis 28, 10 through 19. Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you, and I will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place! This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning, and he took the stone that he had put under his head, and set it up for a pillar, and poured oil on it. And he called the place Bethel, which means the house of God. Jacob lay down to sleep that night with the rock as a pillow, because he was on the run. He had just tricked his brother Esau out of his birthright, and he was going to stay with his uncle Laban while things died down. Little did he know that his uncle Laban would trick him into marrying one daughter when he wanted the other, and into working 14 years for both of them. Amazing how human nature doesn't seem to change through history. But God had a plan and a promise that he had made to Abraham, Jacob's grandfather. God wasn't looking for the most faithful man to work through to fulfill his promise. God's promise did not depend on how faithful Jacob was. It depended on how faithful God was. And to Jacob's amazement, God was there with him all along. We are living in the fulfillment of that promise. Jesus was the one through whom all families of the earth would be blessed. As we come to the table to remember God's promise and God's faithfulness to redeem his people through his son Jesus, there will none of us be worthy. But he asks us to be faithful to him because he is worthy. And the presence of God is with his people, wherever they are. Would you pray with me? Lord, we are able to pray to you because you are faithful and you are worthy. You promised and gave your only son, Jesus, because we were unfaithful
and unworthy. And with great thanks, we remember his body with this bread and his blood with this juice. And we say with Jacob, surely, Lord, you are in this place, and I didn't know it. How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. Through Jesus, we believe and we pray. Amen. Welcome to the tables.
Lay your burden down, every care you carry, and come to the table of grace, for there is mercy. Come just as you are, we are all unworthy to enter the presence of God, for he is holy. Lift up your heart, lift up your hands, fall on your knees and pray for the King of kings, and the love he brings is here in this place. We raise our voices, raise our song, offer him our praise, for the King of kings and the joy he brings is here, he is here in this place. Lay your burden down, every care you carry, and come to the table of grace, for there is mercy. Come just as you are, we are all unworthy to enter the presence of God, for he is holy. Is here in this place. We raise our voices, raise our songs, offer him our praise, for the King of kings and the joy he brings is here, he is here in this place. Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know that saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Let's stand and sing.
Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. A stirring deep within me, could it be my time has come? When I see my gracious Savior face to face, when all is done, is that his voice I am hearing? Come away, my precious one. Is he calling me? Is he calling me? I will rise up, rise up,
and I'll bow down.
My gracious Savior, face to face, when all is done, is that his voice I am hearing? Come away, my precious one, is he calling me? Is he calling me?
stirring deep within me.
Be seated, church.
Well, good morning. Welcome in the name of Jesus. I am not turned on. Hello? I'm on? Hey, don't. Hello, hello. Help me out. Huh? I need a little help. We ready? All right. Yay for help. There we go. There it is. I don't want any amens, but I need as much help as I can preaching. Rod? No, Rod, don't say it. LJ, cut it out. Come on, man. I know that was you, Rob. I know it was you. First of all, I want to extend my welcome back to you guys. Welcome back from Belgium. We can't express how proud we are of what you've done. And I know that it was challenging and exciting, but I want to challenge you with something else. In the ways that your faith was ignited and your light is now shining because of this experience, we want you to bring that back to us. There's something about your experience which is going to be, I mean, it's just different than what you experience here. And we need you to bring that back to us. And don't get frustrated when we aren't as passionate as you guys are. We won't be, but it'll be contagious. And you can lead us in ways, small ways, that you don't really know or realize yet. And for the congregation, we have an opportunity to serve here in the next few weeks, the Green Pastures Church of Christ, which is on the east side, I think it's on the east side of Oklahoma City, has invited us to join in a project to serve underprivileged children that are going back to school here next month in the month of August. So they've asked if we would partner with them to donate some supplies. And we said yes, or at least Kelly and I said yes, and we said yes for you. So I'm not really asking you, I'm telling you this is what we're doing. But you're going to get more information here in the next... actually next week, but here's the three things that we share in this project, our values. We care for children. This is caring for children. Caring for children that might not get the supplies that they're asking us to donate. Two, they're asking us to join with them. It's a call to unity in a world where there's not much unity. And three, they're asking in mid-August, in the days they're asking for us once we collect all the supplies, they want this church and each of the churches that are participating in this project to bring those supplies down on a Sunday evening, and they've asked us to worship with them. And so those are three things that we value: children, unity, and worship. And so we said, yeah, we're in. This seems like something God's doing. So you're going to get more details about that next week. But we want to give you a heads up and begin not asking you, but calling you to join in what God's doing in this small but big way. Let's pray together. Father, as the song says, your ancient words are ever true. They change us. And so today we come with open ears and with open hearts. And we ask that your ancient words impart to us life. And I ask for the gift of preaching. In the name of Jesus, amen. Our text for today is Psalm 139. It's the lectionary text for this Sunday. And as has been our practice during this sermon series on the Word of the Lord, when we finish, I'm going to say the Word of the Lord, and I'm going to invite all of you to respond back, thanks be to God. Psalm 139. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You're familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. For where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you're there. If I make my beds in the depths of Sheol, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting life. The word of the Lord. God, you have searched me. God, you know me. Monima, he knows when you sit down and when you rise. Jason, he perceives your thoughts from afar. Celeste, he knows when you go out and when you lie down. Rick, he's familiar with all your ways. Steve, before a word comes out of your mouth, before a word is on your tongue, he knows it. And John, you travel a lot. Where can you go from his presence? Ezra, Logan, all of you went to Belgium. Where can you flee from his spirit? Kelly, if you go up to the heavens, he's there. Jane, if you go down to the place of the dead, if you go to Sheol, he's there. June, if you rise on the wings of dawn, or if LJ, if you go to the far side of the sea, God is there to guide you. This psalm is a deeply personal and poetic expression of the psalmist's relationship to God. It's not a picture of a distant God with all kinds of attributes, like he's all-knowing and he's all-present. It's a poetic picture of a God who's close and personal. This is not a picture of a God who's like a big brother or some government agencies that knows all about you, every move you make, and even what you're going to do next. This is not a picture of a God who intrudes on your personal space as I did, as you each awkwardly sat there wondering if I was going to call your name next. But it's as personal as me calling each of your names one by one to say, God knows you. It's a picture of an intimate relationship between you and God. He doesn't know things about you. God knows you. It's a kind of relational knowing. It's like siblings, a sibling who knows her sister so well, she can finish her sister's sentences before she speaks them. It's like a best friend who knows what you're going to do before you do it and begins to smile before you even begin to move and act. It's like a parent who knows their child so well, they know their child's needs before their child even needs it. Or it's like my wife, who after 15 years of marriage knows what I'm going to say before I say it and gives me that evil eye which says to me without saying it, you better not say that. LJ, you know what I'm talking about. He has searched you. He knows you. And if you go on to read what we didn't read in verse 12, it says this, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know them full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." And I know how this text is often used, but the point of this text is before you were you, God knew you. And the only response of the psalmist is to say, "Praise be to the God of the universe. Praise be to you, for you knew me before I was me." God, you have searched me and you know me. God knows you. Like a spouse who knows her husband. Like a parent who knows his child. God knows you. Yet by the time we come to the end of the psalm, I find something very ironic. Because the psalm begins with, "God, you have searched me and you know me." And then it goes on this beautiful, poetic thing that we read all the time. I mean, it's one of the most famous psalms. We know it. And then it ends with this. It begins with, "God, you searched me, you know me." But then it ends with this. "Search me, God. Know my heart. Test my anxious thoughts." And I read that this week as I got to the end of the psalm and I just kind of shook my head. I said, "What? What did we just do through the first 20 some odd verses? You just told me how much you know me." And then the psalmist turns around and he says, "But God, search me and know my heart." I don't want to get whiplash and just say, "Wait a minute. I thought he knew me. What's going on?" I was just struck by the great irony in it. But then I went back And if you read the text before, the text that's not actually part of our lectionary text, and for good reason, the verses just before our verse 23, beginning in verse 19, it says, after going through all this praise about God, you know me, how great you are, you know me. And then he says, if only you, God, would slay the wicked. Away from me, you who are bloodthirsty. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, Lord, and harbor those who are in rebellion against you? I have nothing but complete hatred for them. I count them my enemies. To be honest, it's one of the most difficult parts of this text. There's this magnificent poetry and praise of God's intimate knowledge. But the part we just read, it never gets read. At least with this song. It seems to have no poetry to it. It seems to have no beauty in it. But I think its beauty lies in its honesty about the human condition. We don't like reading this part of the text because it perhaps makes us uncomfortable. Or we don't know quite what to do with it. But if we're honest with ourselves, we know the feelings it expresses all too well. We know full well that Jesus says, don't hate. And I teach my children, and you know you teach your children, have taught your children, don't hate. But if we're honest, there's always that neighbor who annoys you. Then there's that coworker you can't stand. Or a boss you just want to tell off. Everybody knows the job situation. You've had a job where you just hate it. Or the politics at work, or maybe worse, the politics at church that just crawls under your skin. When someone cuts you off on the road, you feel that rage well up. The anger you feel, maybe even the hatred you feel when someone says something rude or negative about your husband, or maybe worse, when they talk about your child. Oh, the mama bear. Don't want to mess with the mama bear. We often nurse affronts, and I know I have, on occasion, verbally assaulted people. Waiting for people to get theirs only so that we could be satisfied. Or the feeling of saying, God, I'm on your side, but the wicked keep winning. And if you're honest with yourself, there are people and circumstances that push you to the brink where you just want to shout, I have complete hatred for them. You may not always say it, but if you're honest with yourself, you feel it. And if the psalmist is honest of his praise for the intimacy to which God knows him, or to which God knows us, then he is honest with his request in verse 19. God, if only you would slay my enemy. I have nothing, nothing but complete hatred for them. And the psalmist has good reason for this. They think this psalm, most people think this psalm is written during the time of exile, where Israel finds itself as slaves, as exiled people to Babylon. And so they feel threatened. They feel like they're trying to do the right thing and be the right person. But there's always that one guy. There's always that one lady. There's always that one classmate, or there's always that system that hovers over them that just wants to make you pull your hair out if you had it. I hate you guys right now. Thank you. Oh God, slay the wicked. I have nothing but complete. No, I'm just kidding. But here's what the psalmist does. Like, we ignore these texts, but if you read the Psalms, Psalms are full of this stuff. Because the psalmist knows something, why this is important. And our praise to God and our conversation with God, he knows it's important. One, because there's just something therapeutic. There's just something therapeutic by saying it. I wasn't planning on saying this. My wife has this conversation where she'll say, I know I'm not going to do anything about this, and I know I don't really mean this, but I've just got to say it. And once you say it, you just feel a little bit better. But it's not just therapeutic. There's something about saying confessions or these requests to God, as they do in the Psalms, that reveal to us, once we say it, just how deeply we've been wounded. They allow us to experience and recognize just how deeply we've been wounded. And we could just be honest about it. Because I don't have to know your story. But you're human like I am. And I know all of you, in one way or another, are deeply, deeply wounded. And I'm not even talking about the wounding you do to yourself. I'm talking about all that crud that's dumped on you. The psalmist knows. Here's what the Psalms know, and here's what this psalm is doing. It knows that if you keep these feelings in for too long, these feelings condemn you. And so the psalmist trusts that God is big enough, that God is bold enough, that he's honest enough, that he's powerful enough, that he knows you enough, that you can say these words and God can hear it. Even when they're words about God. But here's what this does more than anything else. Is the psalmist knows when these petitions of just outburst and anger and hatred and just letting it all out come to God. The psalmist knows more than anything else that the reality of life can be brought into perspective once we just say it. For when the psalmist makes his petition for God to slay his enemies, the psalmist and those who pray his words know that this is something that's probably not going to come to bear. Fire won't come down from heaven. And just as we've often pray, and you know this to be true, we'll pray, God, and we'll pray passionately, and we'll let it all out. And sometimes things don't change, if we're really honest. That annoying neighbor doesn't move. And he doesn't even become less annoying. The coworker you can't stand doesn't get fired or find another job. Your boss doesn't get told off. And you don't get transferred to a different department. The situation in your job that you hate does not change. And the work or church politics that crawls under your skin just can't seem to go away. Bad drivers are not cured of their stupidity. And no matter how ugly it makes them look, people will continue to say rude and mean things to you and those you love. The circumstances and the people we hate do not go away, even when we pray, God, do something. And so the psalmist and us, we're left with this. Search me, God. Test my thoughts. Lead me. For God, if I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. And night will shine like day, for darkness is as light to you. God, such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. God, how precious to me are your thoughts. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains on the sand. Even when I wake, I am still with you. So search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting life. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's stand and sing.
exalt thee. We exalt thee.
Spring something on our tech people back there. Alex, if you could bring up that last verse, 23 and 24, here in a moment. This will be our benediction. I'm going to ask you guys to read this together. They pulled it up. I was going to say, while they're pulling it up, afterwards, our prayer team with Andy and Lori Harbor are going to be in the Koinonia room. If you need prayer, they'll be there to attend to you and pray with you. Our benediction. Psalm 139, verse 23 and 24. Will you read it with me? Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. Go in peace.
You, O God, for the Son of your love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above.
I know.
Oh, glory and praise to the God of all grace, who has bought us and sought us and guided our way. Yours is the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Revive us again. We praise you, O God, for your Spirit of life, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Oh, glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, yours is the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, yours is the glory. Revive us again. We sing our praise to the Lamb that was slain. We sing our praise to the Lamb that was slain. We sing our praise to the Lamb that was slain. Yeah, we sing our praise to the Lamb, to the Lamb. Hallelujah, yours is the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, yours is the glory. Revive us again. Sing hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Yours is the glory. Revive us again. Revive us again. Again.